So I'm sure a lot of you have these tools here that are in front of me. The reason why I'm going over these is because I like certain brands, but also specifically the characteristics of these drill bits or the screwdriver bit or the blade here, which help me to do my woodworking to have a higher quality product. I'm just going to go over the basic advantages of each tool real quick, and then we'll go into each one with more depth. So this one says here it's for sliding miters, but I actually use it for my table saw, and it works great to prevent chip out on laminated materials, both sides of the laminated material. And then tape measure here, you want to have a good quality tape measure that will last for a very long time. A belt clip for your tape measure, the center punch countersink tapered drill bits, a Phillips head bit that has some ridges on here, and the screws for the tapered drill bit. So let's move on to the tape measures. Basically, I only look for two things really, is to make sure that the tip is protected. So you have multiple rivets holding in the tip here, and you can see there's three actually holding in this metal guard to keep the tip from getting ruined, especially if you drop your tape measure, because you can drop it right on the tip. So you definitely want to prevent dropping it. I don't worry too much about the tape measure tip here moving in and out. I just check it to make sure it looks reasonable, that it's going to give me some decent measurements and accuracy. But I do like Lumpkin. I don't know why. I think it's just maybe the coating that they have on the tape measure or something, but I don't know. This one I've had like 15 years. So it's starting to get bent here on the sides. And I mean, you can see it just completely worn down, but I'm still using it. I really like it. The rivets are still holding. And I do like the measurements here. I don't like the self-centering one, but I just wanted to show you a Lumpkin type tape measure. But I do like these type of measurements much better. And of course, your tape measure holder, you put this on your belt here. And of course, this is just going to help protect your pants so you don't wear them down. And I used to not use this at all, and my jeans finally started to get worn down, and I started using these, and of course the pencil holder. But it's not just to prevent ruining your jeans. You need to carry your tape measure and pencil with you all the time, everywhere you are in the shop. And you have to always put this back in its place, not on the table, because then you walk away to measure something somewhere else in the shop, and then you don't have your tape measure or pencil to do the work you need to do. And you waste a lot of time traveling back and forth, not actually working. So that's a big time waster, is walking back and forth. You definitely want to avoid that. These drill bits are my favorite. They're taper drill bits. I already have a set, but I bought another one so I could put it in my trailer as a portable set. I love the ones that have some redundancy. So instead of one inset Allen screw, there's two. If you tighten and loosen this multiple times, you're not going to strip it. So that's why I like the Allen wrench. And you can see it's multiple flutes for the countersink. And this is a taper drill bit. So basically, this one's set at for 1¼ inches. If I were to drill a hole for 1¼ inch screw, this is the one I would use. And I just pulled it back just a little bit. But I could go the full length of the screw. There's nothing wrong with that. And of course, the screw gets countersunk at the same time. This one here is the same as this one. And this one's 1 5/8. So I've purchased multiple drill bits so I can permanently set them for different length screws. And you can tighten this really tight so they never come loose. I've never had to ever retighten these Allen wrenches, and I've used them so many times. I have this one set for this is a number 8 drill bit according to the package. It's 11 64ths of an inch, and this one is set for a 2-inch screw. So you can kind of see maybe it's a little too wide, but it works really well, especially the tapered part, the end here, the 2-inch screw will grab really well. You can kind of see the overlap on that. You want the drill bit to only drill the same width as the shank so that the threads will grab. So this one might be a little big, but I still use it for 2-inch screws, it's fine. And then this is a 2.5-inch screw, so maybe a larger one if you don't want to split the wood. So this is a lot thicker shank here. And a 3-inch screw, even when you bottom it out, it'll hit about right here. It'll be a little short. But usually when you're using a 3-inch screw, you do want it to grab really well at the tip so that it pulls two pieces of wood together anyway. Like usually maybe some framing that you might be doing or something that's really thick, you actually want to tighten anyway. So this is hard white maple. So let's do the test on that. This is an old drill bit, so that one's worn out. This is a brand new one here. And of course, with any drill bit, you do want to make sure the material comes out on the sides here. With the tapered drill bit, it tends to stay inside a little more, so you might want to drill as a two-step. So I'll show you with this one. So 1 5/8 inch. Oh, and it looks like the tip is actually chipped a little bit. So this one definitely needs to be replaced. But so you can spin the drill to get the material out. I just do that. Of course, the taper drill bits work best for particle board, so that you will never have the particle board split. This is for like laminated sheet goods that you would maybe you're building some kitchen cabinets, and so you have laminated sheet goods and you don't want the material to split with a drill bit, then you would use these tapered drill bits so that you have the greatest grab and strength on the joint without it splitting the wood. So this is some really hard wood, so we're testing it really hard right now. So you can see here it's loose on that number 8 for a 2-inch screw. That's a thin shank, but here for a 2.5-inch it's much thicker, so that one grabs better. But we'll put it in here anyway. So actually it looks kind of cool. You can see the threads here cutting into the wood. I guess that's one way to test it, see if you have the right depth. You want the threads to go past the hole that was drilled, so that's pretty neat. No threads grabbing here. A few threads grabbing here. So let's see if I can zoom in here for you. You can see there's not too many threads grabbing up here, and then really none at all right here. Of course I used a much thicker drill bit than what I really needed. Should use the number 6, not the number 8. And then over here, there's no screws grabbing here, which is, well, it's fine, because on the 3-inch, you usually want it only on the end so it can pull two pieces together. And then moving on to the bit holder and the Phillips bit. And you can see there's ridges on here on the tip. So I see a lot of Phillips head screwdriver bits that do not have these ridges. And it takes me a while to find them. You know, I did get these at Home Depot. I'm not sure what brand this one is, but the ridges really help to hold the screw. And of course, I look for ones that claim that the drill bit will still work even at a slight angle. So if you can't approach the screw straight on, for some reason you have to come in at an angle, it will still turn the screw. And so this one had that claim. So I went ahead and got this one. This definitely saves you a lot of energy from not having to work so hard to keep the bit inside the screws. And also the bit holder is important. So you can see there's a ring inside there. And so that ring wraps around the notches on the screw bit and it helps hold it in place. That ring also helps you keep your bit inside so that if you get your screw bit stuck inside a screw, it tends to hold into the bit holder better so that it doesn't come out when you pull away from the screw. So when I first bought it, it was really hard to get the bit out with your bare fingers. It does take a while to break it in, but I do find having the ring there helps quite a bit to keep the bit inside. And of course, you want it to be magnetic so you don't have to use any hands to hold the screw in place. And then with the countersink, I like to get one that has multiple flutes. I believe this one has 5. And there's no stop on this one. So there are some countersinks out there that have a stop, which would be a better choice if you want one of those. But this one, I just eyeball how deep I need to go, and I just stop when I match the size of the head for the screw that I'm putting in. And of course, I've done this enough times that I don't need to stop. And sometimes I do want to go extra deep or extra shallow for whatever reason, and so I don't like having ones with a stop on there. But if you have a single flute, it's not going to work very well because you're not going to remove a lot of material. You have to have multiple flutes on your countersink if you're going to use one of these. So with softer material, you probably just need a countersink, not the drill bit. And you don't have to countersink too deep, because it's soft material, it's kind of countersink itself a little bit. So, and then of course a center punch. You can get a spring-loaded center punch, but you basically use this to start your drill bit. So I can take my hammer and mark exactly where I want my drill bit to start on a laminated material, for example. So that way my bit isn't wandering around. And just drill exactly where I need to be. So let's go over this table saw blade. It's 60 teeth. This one has definitely been used a lot. I have not resharpened it ever. And so we'll see how this does in our testing. You can see here the angle of the teeth. It's got a thin curve, and it's a 10-inch, 5/8-inch arbor to fit here on the table saw. The laser cuts help prevent vibration and also noise, I'm sure. And you can see here what it's designed to cut. But what I like about this is the negative 5 degree hook, because this prevents chip out on both sides of laminated material. It actually is designed here, you can see here, for laminated material. It works really well. It's not in the excellent side here, but I actually find it to be excellent. And let's take a look at that. The reason why you don't get tear out while cutting laminated materials on a $20,000 table saw is because they have an undercutter. So basically, you have your saw blade here coming up from the table, and then you have an undercutter that is going to be cutting in this direction. So you can see here. And this one comes up only a little bit above the table. So as you cut your laminated material, the undercutter is cutting in the opposite direction of this one, but it's only cutting a score line on the bottom of the laminated material. So this blade actually pulls the material a little bit to help you push it through. But what it does is it scores the bottom and it matches the exact width of this blade. And once you have the bottom scored and there's no tear out, when this piece cuts from above, it also doesn't have tear out. And so you're actually cutting on both sides with no exit to cause tear out. And that's why when you see in cabinet shops, their blade is raised all the way up. And that's because they have this little scoring blade. And so raising it all the way up, you will never get a tear out on the exit side. And so with this blade, since I don't have a scoring blade, and I have thought about other methods, so I've thought about using tape to tape one side of the piece of laminated material, the part that's going to have tear out. I've thought about actually running my material backwards first and scoring it on my own table saw. So basically I only have the blade up a little bit, and then I slide the material this way to create a score, and then I raise it up and go this way to cut the other side. Obviously I'm doing two cuts. It's a lot of work, a lot of time spent, and it's not really worth it. So what I found to be the best option is to just simply use this kind of a blade, -5 degree hook, and I have a good quality product with laminated materials. So let's go ahead and just see some of the cutting in action. So let's look at the top side that got cut.
I mean, of course, you can still see tear out. And this is a really close-up shot. So basically, look at my thumb compared to these marks here. So these are very tiny. They, of course, they're there. And again, I haven't sharpened my blade ever, and I've done a lot of projects. So here on the back side, there's some more tear out. This one obviously is a big one here. So I don't remember these size of tear outs at all when it was brand new. I do remember some smaller ones, like maybe like right here is what I would get from laminated material right here. These little ones. So they wouldn't actually tear off the laminate completely. It would just kind of chip the top layer of it. And so you wouldn't see the wood underneath, basically.
So what I'm hoping is that someone can chime in to see if they have a different kind of blade that is also negative 5 degrees, like a different angle of the tooth, or 80 teeth, to see if those might be better options, or even a completely different type of blade. But I'm just wanted to share with you the one I've been using for a very long time, and I find the quality to be acceptable when it's new and it's sharp, of course. Right now, it looks like I might need to resharpen it. Or get a new one, but that one I think I've had, I'd have to say like 7 years. So I've done a lot of cutting on sheet goods and all kinds of projects. And of course, if you see that 28 cabinet build I did for the kitchen, that I used that blade and for various other projects. So again, I'm hoping somebody will comment down below about what they use and if they've maybe even used this one and found something better, or if they know there's a better blade out there, definitely better than this one, we definitely want to hear that. And remember, when lifting heavy boxes, lift with your legs, not with your back.